The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at WrestlingWithJonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, Billy, as always. And on this edition of the show, I am joined by your mother's least favourite wrestler, Jay Robin. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me. I put that up as a joke and everyone mentions it to me now.
That's it now. That's your thing.
I'm just going to get the t-shirts that just say that.
I mean, there'll be people to buy them. No doubt people will buy it.
I was joking with my partner the other day because my partner is not a wrestling fan, and really only watches it because I will watch it, or I'm like, he would come to shows because I was on them, and if I wasn't there, he's like, I'm not bloody coming to that. And I was just like, I'm going to get a t-shirt that says my boyfriend's least favorite wrestler, because he doesn't like me, but he loves the Russians. That I had my first match on a show with. He's just, because he's into like politics and communism. He's just like, they're doing Soviet stuff. I like them. And I'm just like, I live with you. But I get nothing from him.
I think we should clarify, just if anyone's listening, I'm sure he means the subject of communism. He's not proper into the communism.
No. Right. No, I mean, I have the Communist Manifesto sitting behind me, but it's just for study reasons.
Right, so the first question is always the same, so how did you get into pro wrestling? What got you hooked?
I mean, funny enough, like, I don't remember how I got into wrestling, I just remember being into wrestling. I used to, like, my aunt and my cousin, my oldest cousin, they were wrestling fans, and they were watching like early 90s. So it was like Ultimate Warrior, and the Macho King, and like stuff like that sort of era, like just pre when Hogan left sort of thing. And I'd be at their house and it's on Sky. And then my first sort of memory of anything is actually Christmas Day. I don't know which year, possibly 92 or 93, but I got just tons of the Hasbro toys. So I had like the Hogans and Macho Kings and Bret Harts, and just that's like my earliest introduction to wrestling. And I wanted to be a policeman when I was younger, and the Big Boss Man was like the king to me. I was just like, nothing is better than Big Boss Man. And like, to this day, I still will go watch stuff with him in it. Like, I'm that much of a geek. I will go watch not just as WWF stuff. I'll go watch WCW or the NWA when he was Big Bubba with Jim Cornette. I love all that stuff. And that's kind of like my early introduction to wrestling. Like, a lot of my early memories as a child is either Batman or wrestling. Like, again, early memories is like, I was at a show 93 and Tatanka was coming to me to the ring. Biggest pop of the night. It's the loudest thing I've ever heard at a wrestling show until I started going when I was an adult. And it's just like, that was my childhood. It was like wrestling, Batman, and Power Rangers. Like, that's all, that was like the formative years of Jay Robin, was just like superheroes and wrestling.
That's all you need, really. I mean, I think my childhood was, well, I started watching when I was 9, so it wasn't really, it was kind of a childhood, but a little bit later on. But yeah, it was wrestling, Spider-Man, Power Rangers.
Yeah, so. I've had this weird relationship with wrestling though, where I watched it till maybe I was like 5 or 6, and then I fell out. And then I got back in 99, 2000, because the Attitude Era and Stone Cold and all that stuff. And then 2002, I fell out again. And then 2016, I left school. And my parents were renovating the house at the time. And so I was sleeping in the living room. So, and this I was just like flicking through channels when it, and Raw was on. I was like, oh, I remember this. And it was like, it was just before WrestleMania 22, like Edge had won the belt like 2 weeks beforehand at the Rumble. And it was just like, Edge is the champion now. Like, I need to watch this again. And since then, I've just kind of like my fandom like reignited, and I got really into just like watching it all the time, and got obsessed with like the history. That's when I got obsessed with like a lot of the history of wrestling. because that's like I love the old Teletubby stuff as well.
Yeah, so I just noticed something when you said you started watching early 90s. I find that you can tell someone watched into late 80s and early 90s, the difference is what they call Randy Savage. Anyone 80s into the end of the 80s, it's Macho Man. But anyone early 90s, it's Macho King. I just noticed that now because I've gone back in previous conversation. I'm like, everyone that watches past 1990 is Macho King. Randy Savage.
I mean, I was born in 89. Like, my birthday's Hogmanay. So I was born Hogmanay in 1989. So 1990, I he was only the Macho King to me. I call him Macho King because the toy, again, like going back to what I was saying about the all the Hasbros, it was the Macho King version with the clown and the scepter. And I was just like, and he just looked so cool. And I had like the tapes, and all the tapes were Macho King with the Queen Sensational Shelley, who's like terrified me as a child. Like, she was a scary looking woman.
My first like experience of Macho Man, I suppose, was he's Macho Man because I don't have a affiliation. I said I started watching 99, so I didn't watch Nitro or anything like that. But I think it was Royal Rumble 94. I think I had it on tape, and he was Macho.
Is that when he eliminates himself?
No, that was 93. But 94 is where I can't remember what it's. I think he's in the Rumble briefly. Oh, no, wait, it is. Yeah, it is where we eliminate. Yeah, 93 is when he tries to pin Yokozuna. 94 is where he jumps out.
Body there. Yeah,
that's it.
He's got...
he was Macho King at that point. And so, like I said, it's something I've just noticed that I can tell when people start watching because of that only. So you got back in the Attitude Era, you saw Stone Cold and what have you. Was there any particular favourites that you're drawn to?
I just remember there was a time just before the Attitude Era, well, it was the Attitude Era that was holding on, but it was like 97, 98. TNT was like came on after Cartoon Network. And the first show they showed on like Friday night was Nitro, and I saw a few episodes of that, and it was Chris Jericho was the vibe. I was like, this guy's amazing. This guy's so funny, and he was doing that cocky heel. I think it was he just did like the 1,004 holds thing, and I remember saying like, oh, it's Monday night, and I was just like, so I was like, okay, Monday night, I'm gonna try and watch this. It was never on Monday nights because they showed it on Friday nights. So I'm like 7-8 years old, so I don't understand that when they say Monday in the UK, it's Friday, because I just didn't have, I was not smart enough apparently to make that connection. And then everyone at school was talking about that, and I got into WWF because of that. And it was like Sean Waltman, X-Pac, and because this is like sort of post WrestleMania 15, it was like Sean Waltman and I think it was the European champion, or Shane McMahon was, but Shane and X-Pac, those two matches, and like, all credit to Shane McMahon, he's really good for what he can do, but Waltman was so, like, just, he was so quick, he was so fast, and as a kid, I was just like, I love Stone Cold, and I love, you know, all the other guys, but like, X-Pac was like my guy, like, X-Pac was, for me, that era's big, like what the Big Boss Man was when I was a young child, because Big Boss Man at that point was like doing like prototype Shield for some reason, and I was just like, I don't like you anymore. But this guy does the spin kicks, and he does the Blanco Buster, and he tells everyone to suck it, and I was just like, this 9 years old, I was like, this is absolutely what I want to watch it at that time.
Yeah, I like when people just come up with, like, not the usuals, like, oh, who's your favourite wrestler, actually, or The Rock? Like, everyone liked The Rock. It's someone else. I like Scotty Too Hotty. So.
Scotty Too Hotty, because of him, I learned how to do the one. And I was at the swimming one time with my friends, and it was just before we go in, but it was, like, all tiled outside. And someone was just like, it was someone's big brother was there, I'd never met him. He's just like, and my friend Michael was just like, oh, Jake can do the one. And I'm just like, no, I can't. I can't do the one. I didn't want to like do it and mess it up in front of this like older kid, because I was like, he's so cool. And I was just like, okay, I'll do it. And I went to do it. And for some reason, I was wearing a belt buckle. And when I went to do it, went right into my private parts. I really hurt myself, so I did one like really bad one. I was just like, that'll do. And I totally embarrassed myself in front of like this guy that I thought like, oh, he's so cool. He's got like PlayStation and all this stuff. And I just like totally messed up doing the one.
So how did you go from watching it to training to do it?
So there was two sort of things. Like I've got like mental health issues like everyone else really does. But I've got anxiety and sort of like a depression from that. In about 2012, I was like at the end of my tether, and I was like, I can't remember what I was doing, but I ended up watching some lesson stuff, and it really inspired me. I tried to get in contact with the company in Dundee. I got in contact with W3L, and I was just like, if I wanted to train, because I was thinking like this, like this, for some reason, it sort of ignited the sort of passion in me to be like, I don't want to do much with my life, but if I'm going to stick around, I want to do something. And like lessons seemed like a good idea. So I was like, sort of contact them, saying like, hey, like, what would I need to do to get involved in that? And neither of them got back in touch with me. But I was able to find something else in my life that kind of allowed me to keep on, you know, keep on trucking. And then my flatmate, when I actually decided to start training, which was 2000 and... it was like May 2018, my flatmate came home, and my flatmate is not the most, what's the word to describe him? Athletic person, I suppose is the word. He never did PE at school. We sat out of it every week with our fake sick note. And he came home one day and he just said, oh, I was meant to be going away on Monday, but I'm going to go away on Tuesday because I'm going to do something on Monday night. And I'm like, what are you doing Monday night? Because he doesn't really go out that much. He just said, oh, I'm just doing a thing. I'm like, what is it? And he's just like, oh, it's a thing. I'm like, what is it? He's just like, there's a less than school just along the road, which it was at the time. It was the Dundee promotion that literally had a school, which is a 6-minute walk from my flat. And he's just like, I'm going to go train to be a wrestler. And I just fell without laughing because I was just like, you're going to be a wrestler. And it wasn't like a nasty thing. It was just like if someone said, oh, he's going to be a wrestler, I would just like, no, that's never going to happen. But I was just like, well, if you're going to do it, I'll go as well. So I went along, and I think he lasted about 6 months or so, and then he stuck around doing other stuff because he's actually a photographer. So I think you've used some of his photos. He's cracked out glass photography. So I think you've used some of his photos, and he ended up doing like ringside photos and promo shots for everyone, but I just like stuck at it because I was just like, like Roddy Piper described wrestling as a sickness, like why, that's why so many guys can't leave. And even just training, I almost felt like I had that, where I was just like, I want to be here. Like even when I'd been there like training 3 weeks, I had to go away for a few days and I missed one training session. And when I was like, I was with my partner, we're away, I think we were in Edinburgh, and I'm sort of looking at my watch going, I should be at training right now. I should be bumping right now. I should be doing something. And it's like, I think after 3 weeks, I was already obsessed with like training and trying to become a wrestler. And that was just kind of my introduction to it. Just like someone said, I'm going to be a wrestler. And I'm like, no, you're not, but I will. And three years later, like I'm still hopefully going to get someplace. And I also started quite late. I started quite late because I'm 28 years old. So.
All right. Well, I mean,
I'm 28 when I started.
The classic example everyone brings out is like DDP and Batista started late, but they were also humongous and athletic and all that. So it's like they started late. Aye, but did you see them at the time?
And the thing that everyone says that to me about DDP, and the thing that I was, again, because this is the history nerd in me, is DDP was in the AWA in the, I want to say late 80s, but definitely the early 90s. As a manager, he was in WCW for a long time as a manager before he was wrestling. So even though, yes, he started to train late, he was already in the business. He had that in. And even if he was never going to be, you know, what he became, which was, you know, television champion, US champion, world champion, he was always going to have something to do in that company, whether it was a jobber or something else. He was always going to be there. So it's like, it's one of those things where like DDP, massive success story. But he was already in the business. Batista's in my opinion, slightly different. But like, again, like you said, humongous. The guy's, I mean, just look at him as Drax. He's absolutely bloody huge. Like, no one's messing with Batista on a normal day. And then like, he gets into lessons, just like, yep, he looks like a bloody wrestler.
It's weird. I was watching, because as of recording, this is just past WrestleMania weekend. So I'm very surprised I'm awake. But I was watching some old WrestleManias, and there was him against Undertaker. I was looking at Batista going, I don't remember you looking like that, because I know you from things like Guardians now, and when you came at his return, he looked so trim and lean. And
yeah, like, I remember first seeing them, because this was just before, this is like a 2002 period where I just kind of drifted away from wrestling. He just debuted on the main roster as Deacon Batista. So I remember them like with the charity box and the suit with the sleeves ripped off for some reason. And then because I would keep an eye on things, and then I'm suddenly just like, oh, Batista's with Triple H and he's wearing trunks. And I'm just like, why the hell did they cover up that guy's body? Like, look at that guy. Like that's money. Like, they are like, it's weird. Like, it's just weird. Like, the way they say, like, they started training late, but they started on second base in a way.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, they started with an advantage to begin with. So, what was that first day? What was that first couple of days of training then? Because I like to ask this one particularly, because I've had most people say it was torture, but I get the odd one or two that seem to be a glutton for punishment. So, what was it like on that first couple of weeks? The first bump, the first cardio. What was that like?
The first cardio, the like just warm ups, like run on the spot. Feet to the butt, all that stuff, that was killer, because I've never been the greatest. I've never had great cardio, and like, even at school, like, I was a sprinter, but I long distance, I was like not equipped for that sort of thing. So that was like, even before I stopped training, or had to stop training, it was like I was still struggling with cardio sometimes. But first bumps, like, I mean, I could, bumps were fine. Like, bumps, like, the way they got us to do them was just, like, go get in the ring and squat down and throw yourself back. Make sure you tuck your chin and close your mouth, because you'll bite your tongue off. And that was it. You know, it was, I really enjoyed the first couple of weeks. Like, looking back now, I'm sure at the time, I was just like, I am so much pain. But, no, I really enjoyed it. The first couple of nights, it was more just like, okay, do a low. Do a forward low, do a backwards low, do a shoulder low, do this, do that. It was like really simple stuff, like those really basic fundamentals that you don't really do that much of later on. So like, it was always fun. Like, I remember like being scared to take a flip bump the first time, because I was just like, I've got to jump, I've got to flip, I've got to land on my back, and I'm not going to do that full rotation. I'm going to land on my head, I'm pretty sure of it. I didn't, but I was sure I was good at that sort of thing. So I was always very trepidatious taking bumps early on, but it took me a long time to... I felt like I could bump quite well after a while, just doing bumps, like, on my own. But if you asked me to take a clothesline, I always, like, felt I was struggling to do them. Like, bumps in matches, I was just like, I'm never going to get the hang of this. That's what I always felt like. And then into learn the ropes... It's the simplest thing in the world. It's three steps and turn. And I think it took me like 2 weeks to learn how to do it. It's like, I'm 28 years old, and it's taken me 2 weeks to learn how to run something. It was just like, it was kind of like, it was internally, I'm sure no one else cared, but for me, it was a little bit embarrassing at the time. But I'm sure no one else, if I mentioned it to someone, they'd be like, I don't remember you taking more than like 5 minutes to do that. But they say that anxiety that I have really does affect things. My partner make fun of me because I've got Italian and I talk with my hands a lot. So if you ever see this, like, that's just me talking with my hands. So I apologize if it's distracting to anyone.
No, not at all. I mean, anyone who watched this could tell when I've watched the Stone Cold podcast, the Broken Skull Sessions, because suddenly I start doing this a lot and just go, because he does this all the time when he's speaking, and I'm just like, this is awful content for the audio version, but I just watched the Jericho one last night, and I'm just like, I'm trying to control my hands.
Yeah, I watched it too. Yeah, so my partner will just come through and just be like, I'll be talking, I'll be doing this, and just like, yes, of course you're doing that. Like, we have pet lats, and the lats, for some reason, have started doing this as well. And every time they do it, he just looks at me and just goes, they're doing it again. And I'm like, I see it. Don't.
So, you did a trade. I'm thinking about the forward roll then. I suppose, like, when you think you don't use the forward roll, I think it gets your, like, body in the frame of mind to tuck.
Yeah.
Head, I think, isn't it?
I'm not entirely sure what the purpose is of it, really, other than it is a fundamental move. At some point, you will use it. I think it probably is a part of the tucking your head. But there was people who would come along who were younger than me, and this kind of shocked me a few times. There's people who come along who are like, you know, maybe they're 15, 16, 17. So they're 10 years younger than me. They're not overweight. They're quite fit. They're quite active, but they don't know how to do a forward roll. And I'm just like, don't they teach this stuff at school? Because that's what I mean. I learned how to do all that stuff at school. And I was just like, I felt I was quite good at them. And then I'm seeing like people struggling with them. I'm like, okay, maybe I can't run the ropes, but at least I can do the forward roll sort of thing here.
I used to be able to do it 5 stone ago, but I think I'd struggle now. I end up just flopping right now. But
the first and the second time I was ever involved in an actual match that was the first Halloween Rumble. I was Finn Balor, and my flatmate was actually Goldust, and he went and did his thing . Ewan G. Mackey's like flirting with him because, you know, it's Goldust and Ewan. Of course, I come in as Finn Balor, and he's meant to come over and he's going to do the whole, you know, the Goldust thing, and I'm going to do the Finn Balor demon, throw my hands up and all that stuff thing. And he starts backing me off into the corner, and I'm like, oh, crap, what's he doing? Because there wasn't really a plan for what we're doing, and I was just like, the only thing I could think to do was like roll out the way as quick as possible. So in the second match, I actually got to use one of the rolls. I was like, I'm never going to use these. And literally, second match, shoulder roll out the way, and then I had to like try and get the headdress off and all my tassels, and try and be Finn Balor for the 2 minutes that I was in that match.
Just what you need when you're in your second match is to worry about a costume at the same time. So what was the first match like then? What was your because you said you're an anxious person. I'm so conscious of the hands now that I've mentioned it myself. You mentioned you're an anxious person. What was it like going out in front of a crowd for the first time?
So the first match I did, which was a battle royal as well, was Hell for Leicester. So it was in the Caird Hall, and this is like my sister and my partner were there, and it was just like I'm already nervous because of that. I'm nervous because it's the first time I've ever been out in front of a crowd. My mum was a wrestling fan when she was younger, and she was taken to the Caird Hall back in the 60s and 70s by her dad. And even though they weren't there, and my granddad's passed away a long time ago before I was even born sort of thing, it was still in my head of going like, this is where my granddad took my mum to see wrestling. Because they, you know, they'd go see, you know, George Kerr and all those guys. And I'm like, I've got to go out and do this. And I was in the back and I'm just like leaning against, I've just got my head against the wall. And my method for sort of dealing with my anxiety when I start having panic attacks is sort of just count to 10. Breathe in for count to 7. Breathe in for 7 seconds. Breathe out for 7 seconds, and then just repeat that until I calm down. And I was doing that for probably about 5 minutes before the match, just like leaning against a wall just behind the curtain, sort of just like, "You're going to be okay. You're going to be okay." And then I got out there, and the moment I actually walked out, and I'm like, "Okay, there was probably only maybe 300-400 people there, but." In my head, it's full, and I'm freaking out. And I follow everyone around, and we're slapping hands with all the fans. I get in the ring, and the moment I got actually in the ring, all the anxiety disappeared. And I was just like, okay, in here, I might not be the best listener. I've only been doing this for 5 months. I'm certainly not the greatest of all time or anything like that, but I at least know what I can doing here that I can't. I don't know what I'm doing when I'm out there in front of fans, like slapping their hands and everything like that, because I've not trained to deal with fans. I've trained to be a less, like lesser in the ring sort of thing. So it was quite nerve-wracking until I was in the ring, and then Grum just beat the crap out of me. like just beat me up for like 3 minutes, threw me to the side, and then Eddie Devine, the Mighty Fine One, jumps on top of me, beats me up some more, and then just eliminates me. I think I was like second out in the whole match.
I suppose in that moment then, because it is a battle royal, you don't have to heavily rely on the character, like you're saying. You can kind of focus on, right, I'm here to do a bit of the wrestling, I'll make sure everyone is safe, I'm safe, I'm out, done, right, that's it. Yeah. One in. I can work on the cheers and boos the next time. And yeah.
There was the other thing, it was just like, because there was no one really had any gimmicks. There was a few gimmicks. Like Eddie was in there, Grum was in there. They were established as like sort of people on the show. But the rest of them were like, it was, I think Johnny Thunder was in there. Yeah, Johnny Thunder was like, he won. But it was like, the rest of us were just trainees. And never did anything. And we were all kind of just like, everyone's wearing like the training t-shirts, so it's, you know, property of Dundee. and I was wearing like my sister had to take me to Playmark, and they were just like, get tights. And I'm just like, where the hell am I going to get tights? Like, so when like my sister was just like, I'll take you to Playmark, and she took me to Playmark, and we bought like women's leggings. So I'm out there for the first time in like in women's leggings and a training t-shirt, and I'm just like, I feel manly as hell.
which
again adds to my anxiety, because I'm like, everyone in here knows I'm really, no one knew. My sister knew, my boyfriend knew, but no one else knew. But I'm in my head, I'm going like, I'm out here wearing women's leggings, everyone can see that I don't know what I'm doing. And once I was in the ring, I was just like, oh, I know how to get beat up. I did it for, you know, 16 years at school. This is easy.
So go back, because there's no structure in this podcast. So go back before training, were you aware of British wrestling at that point? I mean, you said you were thinking of doing it in 2012, and you'd contacted W3L. So did you go to their shows? Did you go to any other companies around about the country?
I didn't really go to shows. I watched stuff online. I went to some of the ones in Dundee, but that was really it in terms of local or British wrestling. But I paid attention to stuff because, like, it's that nerd in me likes knowing what's going on. So even obviously not like now, but before COVID and everything, I was watching ICW and WrestleZone and W3L, and like anytime they put stuff up on their YouTubes or whatever, I was like, I'm like, okay, I'm going to go watch this and like see what's going on there. And it's because at some point you will kind of want to wrestle these people, but also it's just good to see other wrestling that you don't get to see on a local level, because like everyone watches WWE. But I've always said like the greatest wrestling in the world probably doesn't work for New Japan or WWE or AEW, I think. The greatest wrestling more probably works for some indie company. We've just not saw him yet. And that's why I like to try and watch as much wrestling as possible in modern stuff. I watch indies in America, so I like, it's anything I can get my hands on, I like to watch. But British wrestling, I was aware of guys like Zack Sabre Jr., obviously, and like Noam Dar, like the guys who are now in like New Japan and WWE. I was paying attention to them. Will Ospreay, I think, was just kind of breaking out at that point. So I was like very aware of like him and going like, this guy's amazing. Like, he's going to kill himself, but he's fantastic at what he does. I still struggle to watch Ospreay matches, like the older ones where he's doing all his high-flying stuff, because I'm terrified he's going to land on it. I know he doesn't, but I'm terrified he's going to land on his head and break his neck. And I'm just like, I don't want to see that. I don't want to see that. And then he does it, and I'm just like, how do you do that? Like, I don't want to be a high flyer, but at the same time, I wish I could do something like that.
I'm kind of the same with that, with just trying to watch a bit of everything. Of course, because I do a Scottish wrestling website, I've got to try and keep my eyes on everything at some point. I mean, even if I'm not 100% like aware in, or I was going to say interested, but I'm always interested.
Invested.
If I'm not invested particularly, I've still got to try and keep an eye on it, and because you know, content and what have you.
All about that content these days.
This is the 60th podcast I've probably recorded now, so all about the content. It is. I think you're absolutely right. We've never seen the greatest wrestler of all time, because they haven't been discovered yet, or they haven't been on a worldwide scale, or what have you. And also, on you go.
I mean, you could go back 10 years ago. I think he was in the WWE at the time, but Daniel Bryan was the greatest in the world for years, but he never worked any of the major companies. It was WWE, so it was Ring of Honor, it was Dragon's Gate, it was things like that. He was never in WWE until we eventually got signed, but he was the greatest for years. AJ Styles was one of the greatest. He'd never been in WWE, and that's why I always say that the greatest wrestlers. Yes, there's great wrestlers in WWE. Cesaro is fantastic, and Seth Rollins is amazing. And if you go to New Japan, like Kota Ibushi's fantastic, and Will Ospreay, and Okada, I think, is definitely on the shortlist for one of the greatest of all time sort of thing. But they're great, but there's guys that we've not discovered, we've not seen yet, that are just thinging away. And like, when you eventually see them, you go, like, holy crap, like, this guy has got it. He's got the thing. He's got the look, he's got the ability, he's got the psychology and everything. I remember seeing Adam Cole in early Ring of, when he just debuted in Ring of Honor, when he was Future Shock with Kyle O'Reilly. I remember seeing those two together as the tag team. I think it was Future Shock. But I remember seeing them as a tag team, and I've seen them there, and they are two of the best in the world right now. I love seeing that as well.
And also because wrestling's so weird, it's so subjective. Like, I've never seen an Okada match. Never seen one. Oh. So I don't know if he's the greatest wrestler of all time. But I've seen plenty of Daniel Bryan matches. I've seen plenty of Cesaro matches. So I can see... I have my favourites, of course. Everyone does. But I'm always open to other people saying who their favourites or who they think is the greatest of all time. Because to them, they are.
My controversial opinion on possibly not the greatest of all time, but I think he's vastly underrated today because people only think of him as a commentator, but is actually Jerry the King Lawler. Like, the King ran Memphis for 30 years as a main event star. He never had to travel any place. Name one other person in a territory who did that, and yet he had sellouts every single week. And it was sellouts constantly. And it's just like, why? It's because of Jerry Lawler, because he was so over in that territory. And no one was over in a territory like Jerry Lawler ever was, because everyone had to move. Not Jerry. He was so good. And if he went to Florida for a few weeks, the business in Memphis went down. Every time. And you can go back, and it's just like, and that's what it's like. When I say, oh, Jerry Lawler's like fantastic. And I was just like, the puppies guy. And I'm like, oh, no. Ignore his commentary. Go watch his lesson, especially in 82 to like 86. It's amazing.
I mean, even when we're strictly speaking about his wrestling, because like his outside and his opinions and things like that, in a bit of dodgy ground, but his wrestling itself,
always trying to have to separate that from the thing, because I'm straight edge. So I'm like CM Punk. I don't smoke. I don't drink. I don't do drugs. According to my friends, I'm no fun. But you look at a guy like Ric Flair. Like, I do not agree with like the way he treated his body. Like, he, like, the amount of drugs and drink and women he did. But as a wrestler, as like one of the best of all time, absolutely, he's in the conversation. You have to separate that thing, and what Jerry Lawler's personal life is. A plethora of just amazing content to talk about, but not on this podcast.
But no, you know when Jerry Lawler, I mean, I think people looked down on it because it was for the WWE title, but when Miz won the title in 2010 and his first big feud after Orton was the King.
Yeah.
And I still, I mean, I'm a big Dirty Mark. So, I mean, I was 20 at the time.
Hey, if you're in, I don't care what anyone says. If you're in the wrestling business, you're the big Dirty Mark.
Oh, you're the biggest.
That's why you're in the business. If you're not, you wouldn't be here.
Oh, I'll get back to that in a second. But yeah, when I was speaking of that, I was speaking to Molly Spartan for a podcast that hasn't gone out as of recording. And pretty much she was saying that, yeah, wrestlers are the biggest marks because they went and did it. So,
yeah.
Of course you are. You're the biggest ones there because you actually went to do it. But anyway, yeah. But I was still... I almost believe Jerry Lawler could be WWE champion in 2010. And that's testament to...
He's that good.
Yeah. It's just madness. But yeah, wrestling subjective. That's kind of the whole... That's how we got to that point. Because I like a bit of comedy. I like Kevin Owens, as an example. Doesn't look like a wrestler. But he'll make you laugh, he'll make you vested, and he'll do it safely and amazingly and all that kind of stuff. And he doesn't look like he should be a typical wrestler, but he's one of the best in the world, I would say.
Yeah. See, I like Kevin Owens. I like AJ Styles in TNA when he was Christian's sidekick.
Yes.
That sort of comedy. I like that comedy in wrestling where it's believable. It's like wrestling comedy is so bad, especially because everyone thinks wrestling comedy should be like what WWE does wrestling comedy, and it's terrible. But like Santino Marella, I hate that. I hated that gimmick. I hated whenever he was on screen because the guy can have... If you make a joke of the guy, that's fine. Once or twice. Oh, that's part of this thing with, you know... The way Kevin Owens does. But when you have comedy wrestlers, and everyone in Dundee used to make fun of me, they would take the mick out of me because they'd do something like really stupid or silly, and I'd just like be shaking my head going like, we'd all be killed. Like 30 years ago, if we tried to do something like this, like Harley Race would have taken us in the back and just slapped out of us. Eh? And like, it's like comedy is like wrestling is subjective, but wrestling comedy, there's great guys who do it. Sami Zayn is very funny. Kevin Owens, like I say, AJ and TNA was hilarious. I like the New Day stuff sometimes, but it's like there's guys like Santino Marella or there's a lot of the stuff in like Impact, especially today. I just can't watch. Like I cannot watch that stuff.
I mean, speaking of Santino, yeah, I mean, but even in, I think. Was it 2010 as well? This must be a weird year. I might have to go back and watch some of it. But even...
Was this when he was in the Elimination Chamber?
Yeah. It was 2011. It was 2011. Because
he made him like US champion, and they were just like, there was a rumour that they were going to make him serious and thingy, and they put him in the Elimination Chamber, and he got just destroyed, and then two weeks later, he was back to doing comedy. It's like... Well, that was a waste of time.
That was 2011 because he was the final two with Alberto Del Rio in the 40-man Rumble, and everyone was going mental that he was going to win. And then a couple of weeks later, he was in the final two of the Elimination Chamber with Daniel Bryan. Then folks thinking he was going to win because he hit Bryan with the Cobra. And everyone was just going ballistic, thinking that he was going to be World Heavyweight Champion. But you know, like I say, subjective. People loved that. You didn't.
Yeah.
That's where it comes from. Anyway, right, we've went way off tangent.
Yes,
as was the worry when we do these podcasts. So we'll go back to your wrestling career a bit. So a couple of matches.
I've never had one.
I don't know. We'll use journey. Would that be better? Wrestling journey.
It's a very short journey. It's just to the bottom of the street, really. Journey or career, it's a weird way to describe it because it was, I started training May, discounting lumbos and different things like that. I had my first match on a show in the February 2019. That was a student showcase show, which I'm told didn't count. And then I didn't debut properly until... I think September was my first match on an actual like main roster show, and I did basically nothing in between that other than referee, and I that was kind of my thing. I did like a Rumble spot, and that was it. And then I did the things I did, and then we were done because pandemic.
But I mean, a couple of matches in, one I wanted to like just speak about briefly, because you're, as you say, you're a bit of a history nerd when it comes to wrestling, the business, and just general. One of the matches you had was the crossover with W3L. You teamed with Mike Musso against John Kerr and Blondie Barrett.
Yes.
So as someone who is a bit of a wrestling nerd, what was it like getting to the ring with Blondie Barrett?
I wasn't even meant to have that match. I wasn't meant to be in the match. So the night before, there was the match where I won the Showcase title. And there's a whole story behind that, but essentially, I was not originally planned to win that. I wasn't going to be the champion. John was leaving. And not a lot of people knew, and he kind of told people the day before, and they were just like, okay, like, we need to make a decision about what we're going to do. Let's move it to Jay just now, since I had, you know, I had the title shot match that day. The next day I show up, and it was meant to be John Kerr versus Blondie Barrett in the singles. And then they showed up, and they were just like, Mike Musso came along with them. I'm not entirely sure why. I think Mike might have been told he was booked, but other people hadn't. And the promoter had... I don't exactly know the full story, but Mike Musso showed up as well with Blondie, and they're getting changed. And it was just like... John Kerr comes up to me, and again, I'm still not booked on the show. I was ringing the bell. Like, I did the bell for the first match. And John comes up to me, and he's just like, you got your gear? I'm like, yeah. So you got the bell. Like, of course I've got, like, because like you're going to a show, you take your gear. That's the thing. So even though I wasn't booked, I thought I'll take the stuff. I'm just like, yeah, he's like, go get your stuff on. It's gonna be I think Mike and Blondie haven't showed up yet. Like it looked like they weren't gonna show up. So it's just, it's gonna be me and you, we'll have a rematch. Don't worry about it. Like we'll work it out in the ring. I was like, cool. So I went and got changed, and then they showed up. It's just like, oh, it's just gonna be a triple threat with us three. And it's just like, no, it's going to be a tag match now. So go grab your stuff, and we'll go have a quick plan. And sitting back in the stairwell, we were planning the match, and it's like me and Mike and thingy, and they're just like, oh, well, who do you want to go over? And I'm just like, well, look, the less the nerd than me, I'm just won the belt the day before. And I'm going, oh, I'll take the pin. I don't care. Like, and Blondie was just like, no, you just won the belt. We'll pin Mike because, like, you know, like, because they were going over, and it's just like, get in the ring, and it's just like, get in there. And I never touched Blondie. Like, me and Blondie never touched in that match. I think he gives me a clothesline at one point, and that was it. He closes, like, he does the clothesline, and I go backwards over the ropes, and that was it. The rest of it was caretaking heat for me and Mike, and it was like, and I'm like, this Blondie Barrett. Because I mentioned to my aunt that Blondie Barrett's going to be at the show. It's just like, okay, no, Nagasaki's partner. I was like, yeah, like that guy. She's just like, oh, that's really cool. So, like, because they watched World of Sport and that, and I'd not saw a lot of Blondie. Like, I'd watched a bit of World of Sport because it's on YouTube, but I hadn't watched a lot, but I knew of him. I was just like, I'm getting to share the ring with her, but I'm talking too fast and I'm getting the hiccups and stuff. I get excited talking about wrestling. So I'm just like, I'm opposite the ring against the guy who wrestled on World of Sport. I don't think World of Sport was even on when I was born. This is insane. So, and like, that was one of the few times I didn't have anxiety going out for the match, because I was going out with John, who I think is a fantastic wrestler. Like, he's 17, 18. I think he was 17 or 18 at the time, and obviously he's however old he is now. But I was like, and he's fantastic, and I thought he has got so much potential. And then I was like, I'm teaming with Mike, who's like 15, 20 years he's been a wrestler, like, and he's a proper journeyman. And I know like he'll be able to like talk to me and like help me through this. And then Blondie Barrett's in the opposite corner, like be in the face, wanting to beat me up, and I'm just like, this is awesome. Like, these guys are gonna like take care of me. Like, I wasn't nervous about going out there because we had bits and pieces that we knew we were gonna do, and then we had two veterans communicating with us as well, telling us like how to do this, and it was great. Like, I like to kayfabe. Like, I don't like talking about it. Like, it's like we all know what's going on, but in that moment I was marking out because I'm just like, I'm with Mike Musso against Blondie Barrett. This is awesome. And I called him an old man at the end of the match, and he was just like, don't call me an old man. Don't. I was like, okay.
Also, you didn't have the time. You didn't have the time to be anxious. By the sense of it, you didn't have the time to overthink it. It was just like, right, this is what we're doing. Okay, that's what I'm doing.
There. What literally happened was, Kerr comes up to me at the end of the first match and says, you got your gear? I'm like, yeah. Okay, go get changed. We're going to have a match. I think there was another match. I think it was... Because there was no times for the matches that night. Normally you get told, oh, you got 8 minutes or whatever, but they were told, it's the match, last show of the year. It doesn't really matter when we get out of here because it's an 18-plus venue, so they're quite cool with us being here to, like, whatever. I said, okay, so don't take the mech, but, you know, 20 minutes or so. So the first match went, like, I think it was, like, 17-18. Second match, I think it was Lane and Ashley Vega, I think. And they got told, you know, take as much time as you need. So they took, like, you know, 20 minutes or so. And then we're stalling because Mike and Blondie now show up and that. And we were going to go on third. And I was just like, send Ewan and Zach Leon out because they need to set up a match. So they went out and they did like 15 minutes of like just promoing on each other and like chasing each other and that. And it was just like, thank you like so much to those guys for actually doing that. So we had like a bit of time, but all that time was spent, let's get this done, let's we'll do this, we'll do this. And I'm sitting there as Blondie Barrett's like putting his boots on going like, so I'm going to clothesline you out the thing and you just need to land. And can you do that? Like, yeah, of course I can do that. Just like, excellent. Let's go and do it. It's like, cool. Blondie Barrett's going to clothesline me at the thing. And he was meant to clothesline me on one side, but there was a table. Like, there was a table for the main event that night that they'd set, but they just, rather than put it under the ring, they put it at the side. And that's all like, oh crap, I'm meant to go out on that side. Oh, I'll just go to the other side. So I went to the other side and I went to do it. And what I forgot was, I'm like 5'10", 5'11". And as I get clotheslined out, there's a balcony just beyond the ring and my feet sort of scrape it as they go on. So if I'd fully extended my legs, I would have caught it and just been caught on this balcony. But it was such a strange match to be like, I'm not even on the show. And I somehow ended up teaming up against Blondie Barrett and one of the guys that I really respect in terms of training, which was John Kerr. And then I'm teaming with Mike Musso, who's, again, I think he's been 20 years, might be longer, but like a vet who just knows what he's doing. He's such a journeyman in that. And like, hopefully he books me one day.
So, I mean, I was getting my timeline mixed up then. I knew it was right about the same weekend, but same eight timeline. You won the belt off John Kerr.
Yeah.
As you said, you didn't really mean to be winning that, but circumstances meant you did. Are you a belt guy? Was that something you were really excited by, being a champion?
Am I a belt guy? My WWF belt up there.
I don't want to flex, but you know.
I will point this out because I was saying earlier about X-Pac and Shane, and they were feuding for the European title. The big gold. Like the WCW, NWA world title, WWF world heavyweight, WWE world heavyweight, is the most beautiful belt in wrestling. I will argue that to death. The second most beautiful belt in wrestling is the one right behind you right now. That is my favourite belt, yeah. And it's purely because of X-Pac and Shane back in the day.
I think that's why I loved it as well, because WrestleMania 15 was my first WrestleMania, my first VHS as well. So seeing that belt, and I was like, oh, I fell in love with that belt straight away.
It's so simple. It's like, I will buy wrestling figures. I will spend like £10, £15, £20 buying a wrestling figure because they have a belt that I want to put on a different figure, and then I will take that figure and just throw it away. I'm a belt mark in terms of I like the designs, I like things like that. I'm not a belt mark in terms of like I want to have these belts, like I want to be the champion. It wasn't about that. To be honest, being the champion wasn't that fun for me. It was cool to have it, in that moment. Like, if you watch the I was going to say if you watch the footage, but you can't because they moved it recently for some reason.
I think someone's put up a little clip of it at the end somewhere. I have seen it. I think it was you.
I don't want to do a shoot on anyone or go off on that. I'll do a little thing on that just after this. But where was I? I was thinking, it wasn't most fun having the belt because I got it. I wasn't meant to have it, and it kind of felt like that. And if you watch the footage when I win that belt, it's fifth. I've timed this. Like, this is how sad I am. I timed it from the moment it's 1, 2, 3. Dawn, who you had on podcast a bit while ago, she's one of my best friends in wrestling. She supported me so much, and I've tried to support her as much. But the fact that she was the referee and we kind of started doing stuff on the student showcases together, like, that was a big moment that I got to share with her, and I was really happy I got to do that with her. But it's 15 seconds from when I win, like the three, to when she hands me the belt. It felt like hours. I'm sitting there and I'm just like, because I am in shock. Like, I'd found out shortly before the match I was winning. I don't think it fully sunk in until I got that. And I'm like, I've won. Holy crap, like, that's, you know, my brain's exploding, and I'm looking at Dawn going, hand me the belt, it's been like an hour, come on, I need to get out, there's other matches on tonight. And then she hands me the belt, and if I'd known I was winning way in advance, because you spend time going before, like, oh, it'd be like, if I win, I'm going to do this, and I was thinking, I'll do the Seth Rollins and spin the belt. No, I can't, because there's a low roof, so I can't do that. Or maybe I'll do, like, I'll lay it down and I'll do the Shawn Michaels, like, the boyhood dream has come true thing, or something like that. In the end, I just look at the belt, shaking, stand up, put it over my shoulder, wave to John because he's going to the back because I've, you know, defeated him. And I look at the belt. I try and climb up on the middle rope to celebrate because my mum and dad and my sister are, like, there. And, like, I'm too tall because the roof's so short, so I kind of hit the roof with the belt. I jump back down, I look at the belt, float down on the thing, roll out, pick it back up, and then just before I walk through the curtain, I'm just like, a new champion. And then I walk backstage and I collapsed. I felt like, just like inside Gorilla. I just walked down, I just fell over, and I was like, what the hell have I done? because it's like, this is like, I wasn't meant to be champion. I have no problem admitting that, but I was the champion. And someone picked me up and took me through to a corridor just behind Gorilla that was in. And people were coming out of the left because no one knew. No one really knew this was happening. And they're coming out of the left and all they see is me sitting there holding this belt. And all these just like, oh man, like, something's happened. And then people, and it was kind of, one person saw how I was, I don't know if they thought I was like upset or in shock or something like that, but once someone texting came past me and said, oh, don't worry, it'll just be a transitional lane. And the wind just, okay, just really, like,
it took the shine off the wind.
Yeah. And that whole sort of, between that show the next night, and then we were off for January because the school was moving from the place a couple of minutes away to its new location. We didn't train, and I felt like I hadn't deserved it. And at one point I was thinking about messaging people in charge and being like, where do I drop this belt off? Because I just want to give it back. I don't want this. Because when I met up with people who were wrestlers, who were my friends, they looked at me like I didn't. I felt they were looking at me like I didn't deserve it. And they were looking at me like, you didn't earn that. And I was determined when we got back to training to prove that I earned it, to prove that I deserved to actually, at least, maybe not carry it for a long time, but carry it for a period of time and have a couple of matches defend it. Because if you have a title and you don't defend, and you defend it once and you lose it in that defense, it kind of dims the light of that person, in my opinion. And there was people talking in front of me. I don't want to go too negative with this, but there were people talking in front of me, two people in power going. So I'm thinking at the next show, we'll do a thing where I'll challenge Jay and then he can come out and we'll do this thing and then I can win the belt and that way we get it off him. They're doing this in front of me. And I was like, I hated, like, it really killed any excitement I had for the belt early on. And I was trying to like pitch ideas to at least get to do something. I talked to Kev Williams and I was just like, what do you think about doing Showcase Champion versus Breakout Champion in W3L? Because Roderick Jones had just won the Breakout Championship. I thought, it's like the two sort of similar levels. Let's do that. And he was just like, oh, we can think about that. And I was basically told that people just wanted to get the belt off me right away as quick as possible. And it was very deflating. And it took me a long time because of that to feel comfortable holding that belt. Even just at home, like my flatmate and my partner will laugh at me for this, but I would walk around the house, and I'm sure there's people watching this going, like, such a mark. But I would walk around the house carrying the belt, not to be like, I'm the champion. It was, I need to find a way to carry this belt that makes me feel like I am a champion and I deserve to hold this belt. Just like we have comfortable to me that when I walk up to the ring, I can do it. And what ended up happening was I only ever got to do it once on a show, but I bandoleered it around, I think, and I had the actual main plate on the back because my idea was, well, I'm the champion. The belt doesn't matter. I'm the actual champion. That was the eventual idea I had in that. But because of just how people sort of treated me, that it felt crap. It didn't feel good being a champion for a long time.
I mean, just from our brief chat just now, you've talked about your anxiety and things like that as well. So, I'm sure people knew that's how you were before matches and after matches. So,
I don't know if everyone knew, but I think there was certainly people who I was close with who were either aware I had anxiety or had saw me taken 5 minutes before I went out to breathe and just to calm down and chill and be like, just center yourself sort of thing and that. And then, you know, the match, like, I'll admit that match was not my greatest match. And it certainly wasn't John Kerr's match. He's had infinitely better matches than that one. But it was the match that we had. And it was the match that, because of circumstances where I think I was probably in shock of being told, oh, you're winning this match at the end, by the way. And I think John, this is his last night or second last night in the company, and everyone's sort of finding out and everyone's just like, oh, we're going to miss him and that. I think, I don't know, I can't speak for John, but I think it sort of affected him as well in that way. So I would love to have a match with him again when we're both like level-headed and things. Because I think he just wanted, like, let's get this over with. Let's try and do the best we can. And we did okay, in my opinion.
I suppose it's the flip side of being told minutes before that you're going to be opposite the ring to Blondie Barrett, and then on the other hand, minutes before going, oh, you're going to win this title, but you're not going to hold it for long. So don't worry about it. It's the worst thing you can say to someone with anxiety, because that's what you're going to do for the whole time. Right, let's go to happy things then. Let's lift this up. I did my research. I did a little bit of research beforehand. Unfortunately, you're quite elusive to find on the internet. But I did find out things. Of course, you said Batman, J. Robin being your name.
Like the Batman shelf is like behind me, actually.
And of course,
my Batman shelf and my Robin and Nightwing comics. You actually can't see there's a Robin display just off the side here with all my Robin stuff.
And of course, your gear design is very reminiscent of Robin as well.
Yes, very deliberately so.
So, what was it about Batman and his cast of characters that drew to them?
Okay, I'll say the probably controversial thing. Batman is the most boring character in the world. Batman, like, I love saying this to people, because especially comic book nerds, because they get so riled up about this. Batman is a white Anglo-Saxon Protestant. He's a wasp. He's the most boring character in the world. But at the same time, he's got the coolest imagery in the world. And he's got that car, and he's got He's got all the gadgets and the belt and the cowl and just the cape, and just he looks like a badass, but he's boring as hell. But I don't know why Batman and those cats, because I got into the animated series when I was like, because it was like, it starts in 92, so I'm like 2, 3, 4 years old when it's ailing. It's fantastic. Like, I'll go, I've got the DVD collection, I'll still go watch that stuff today. There's some just like some absolutely bangers. But I would watch 1966, like the 66 show used to be on one of the kids' shows. I used to watch that. I don't know, there's something about Batman. I think I was bullied as a child. We're going to go dark for just a second. But basically, my family, like history is Polish Italian, and they came over after the war. This is on my dad's side, and I'm named after my granddad. Spoilers, my real name is not actually Jay. but I was bullied a lot at school. And because of my name, and just I'm the weird kid who likes superheroes and comic books and all this stuff. And like Batman and Robin specifically, which is why I'm such a big Robin fan, was like spoke to me in some way. Like there was something about it that was like, there's always, Robin specific is really plays into it of there's always, no matter how dark things are, and this is like, there's always a bit of brightness, and that's what Robin was to Batman. I think that's why I was always looking for that brightness in my life, because when I was a child, when I was like between the ages of like say 5 and 12 or 13, when I stopped giving a fuck what people think. Sorry.
That's your one.
That's my one, sorry. when I stopped giving a clap about what people thought, at like 13 and that, like that period of time, I was just like, Robin kind of spoke to me. And when I came out as queer, I also got into the X-Men and that, because like it's the outsider team of like these like people who like hate and fear them, but try to protect the world. Like, not that I'm trying to do that, but like, just want to live my life sort of thing. And I just like these characters that are like the brightness to the darkness, and just want to trying to do good even though everyone hates them sort of thing. That, sorry, caught the cable. I'm all over the place today. This is what happens when you speak with your hands.
but I was just about speaking about Robin as well. It kind of it harkens back to a joke. It's joke and Scrubs, but it works in this basis as well. If you grow up anxious, bullied, you don't feel like you should be the main character. So you're not going to be Batman.
No.
But you're going to be there. You're going to be doing the same job just about, but you're not going to be the focal point, which is Robin.
Yeah, there's definitely an aspect of that. Like, I never related to Batman the way I related to Robin, or even to, like, Nightwing or Red Hood or Red Robin. Like, the characters that these, the other, like, the Dick Grayson Robin becomes Nightwing and Jason Todd Robin becomes Red Hood. When they become those characters, I love them. I have their books. I have collectibles of them in the cabinet over there. But I didn't relate to them as much as I do to whoever's Robin at the time, like the Tim Drake Robin, and who was the 90s and early 2000s Robin. That was my Robin. And then like the Damian Wayne Robin, like who's like the flip side of that almost. Like he's the darkness, and when they made Dick Grayson the original Robin, they made him Batman. So it was bright Batman, dark Robin. And I love that dichotomy of just like switching the thing and that. And again, related to like these angry, because Damien's an angry kid because he feels like his dad doesn't love him, which my dad does. My dad, like me and my dad got on really well, but like this idea, like, you know, like people don't, he feels like he's got to prove himself and people don't love him and people always try to put him down in that. And he just wants to sort of be a part of a world with his family sort of thing. I can relate to that in the sense of like, as a queer person, you can often feel like you're not part of society in a way. Like it can feel like you're very much an outsider, no matter how integrated you are into it. That if you're queer, it can feel like there's always, I can say one wrong thing and suddenly I'm no longer included in the group. You would never do it to a straight person, but you would do it to a queer person. Not saying you, Billy, but just in general. And that's what it can feel like at times. So again, like the outsider characters and just that blindness. Like I needed the blindness and the anxiety and depression and that. Like fucking Blight colours, and the Blight characters, the Blight bubbly characters, they speak to me. Despite the fact that I want to be a bad guy and a heel on the show and flip that idea.
Sorry, I think we've got one question about Batman. It seems to be like
Dawn.
Yeah, it seems to be like it's like a trigger subject. As soon as I've mentioned Batman, he's like, right, everything about Batman. So we've got Dawn coming in with, of course, Dawn Devlin, who did an Untitled podcast, as you mentioned, which you can go check out in all the places. You have to choose one iteration of Batman in its entirety. Every other one that gets erased from history, which is it?
Okay, she was actually up at my flat for night one of WrestleMania. And I told her the answer then. I gave her two answers. There's two answers. One, if you're going to pick one specific version, it has to kind of be the animated series, because the animated series covers Batman, the Superman spin-off, because he was featured in that. It features the Justice League cartoons and Batman Beyond, and like the spin-off movies they did from all those things. And that is like pure quintessential, the best Batman of all time, the best version. But there's not a lot of it, and that is why, because it's quality over quantity. But I got to pick the original Batman in the comics from 1939 to today, because if you don't have that, you don't get the movies, you don't get the cartoons, you don't get anything else. It always has to come back to those comics. So I'm going to say like the comics, because like I'm a nerd in that way. I have a massive comic book collection, so I'm always going to say the comics.
Just out of my own curiosity, live action Batman, which is your favourite? Actually, I'm sorry. I'll put an addendum to that. Best live action Bruce Wayne, best live action Batman, because you know that kind of changes things a little bit.
Okay. Best. That's hard. Best Batman, and a lot of this is based on his look, because the outfit looks so damn good, is Batfleck. I'm going to have to give it to Ben Affleck on that one. Best Bruce Wayne? Keaton, probably. Michael Keaton. Like the 89 Batman Returns, like Joker, like the Tim Burton version, like those, like, is it Michael Keaton?
Keaton's Burton's, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So yeah, like he's probably the best. I think he's probably the best Bruce Wayne. Personal favorite though is actually of both is Adam West.
I thought you were going to say Val Kilmer. I don't know why I had it, because you're going to say Val Kilmer. Why? Don't say Val Kilmer.
I'm one of the few people in the world who would defend not Val Kilmer. I will never defend Val Kilmer's. I will defend George Clooney's though. I love that movie. It is so bad, but it is the 90s version of the 66 TV show.
I was gonna say, and it's so camp that
it's so cartoony. Like if you were making 66 in the 90s, that's what it would have looked like. Maybe without nipples, but you could have had, that was the look you would have wanted. But George Clooney apparently keeps a picture of that Batman, like that outfit, on his desk. And whenever he's looking at things, just like I would never do anything as bad as this. And I'm sitting there going, oh, George, that was one of your best movies.
I liked it, but I don't have a... I watched... this is going to probably be a controversial opinion, maybe. I watched the Snyderverse version of Justice League.
Not watched it yet.
Oh, what a boring film.
That's what everyone says to me, it's boring, and it's kind of like Game of Thrones. It's on my list of things I will watch. It is just not high on my list of things I will watch. I'll go watch like The West Wing again, or Sons of Anarchy, or Bones, or Law and Order. So I will re-watch those shows before I go watch new stuff. And like Snyder Cut I was not impressed with Man of Steel. I was happy with the last act of Batman vs. Superman when Wonder Woman shows up. I was not really impressed with just the stuff that Snyder had done in with the DC characters. So I was like not fully committed to a Justice League. I wasn't that bothered by the theatrical cut. I thought it was fine. It was a good movie. It wasn't a great movie. It was what it was. Like, I'm told they've fixed some of the things that that movie had issues with, but you can like pluck through the plot holes in that movie, but it was what it was. It was Justice League on screen. Like, I'm just happy to see Justice League on screen. Like, as a comic book nerd, like, I'm just happy to see that stuff.
Well, this will be a whole other different podcast entirely, but yeah, I'm just of the opinion of they've saw what the MCU have done. I love the Marvel films, so that's...
They should have just did that. They should have just did what the Marvel movies did.
They went, oh, we've done Superman. Oh, we don't need to worry about anyone else. We'll just do a big Justice League one.
It'll
be fine.
We'll do it in the verse. We'll build. Yeah. We'll do the big thing, and then we'll build backwards. Because Wonder Woman's a fantastic movie. Wonder Woman, the first Wonder Woman, is fantastic. It's easily the best DC movie they've done. Shazam is a decent movie, mostly because they kept it away from everything that they'd already done. But that's why I think like The Flash and The Arrow and Supergirl and Clark and Lois or Superman and Lois? Like the new one and Legends of DC. Yeah, Legends of Tomorrow, all that stuff. The TV universe they created, that's miles better because they basically like, yeah, it's a TV show, so it's slightly different, but they basically just did what the Marvel did. They built up these characters over time. And then they decided to put them into the big crossovers that your Crisis is or whatever. But your TV does it well enough. Just steal that idea. And if anyone says, oh, you're just ripping off Marvel, be like, yeah, because it was bloody successful.
Absolutely. It's been over 13 years now, and it's still the highest profit franchise probably in the world. I think it's overtaken Harry Potter, even though it's done it on more films, but that's a whole different story.
I took Bond like 40 years to make as much money as like Marvel did in like 5.
People just like superheroes. That's just it's a crossover for us as well. Like you say, you were Power Rangers, Batman, wrestling. I was Power Rangers, Spider-Man, wrestling. So it's all superheroes at the end of the day. It's just it's just a live action every week of the year, which is weird.
I mean, that's the thing. Wrestling is just like it is just superheroes. Like that's they wear spandex. Some of them wear capes. They wear masks. Some of them. It's superheroes and supervillains and like that was like one of the most funs I ever had in the ring was actually is the last thing I did was the fast track. At one point, I rolled out the ring. And there's like some kids like behind me, and they shout like this, they got light up there, and they're screaming light in my ear. And I just turned in, like being light over the top of them, just started screaming at them, just like, you're here to see me, all that stuff. And you can see they're just like, okay, we're scared of you now. And it was just like, I was just like, that's what it's like when you see villains in the movies and they stand up, and everyone's just like, oh crap. Like it felt like that. It was like for me, like as a comic man, it was kind of cool to feel that. And that was like that's probably one of my favorite moments. One of very few, but there's a few of them that I thought that was just like awesome. Like to get to do that. And then someone immediately beats me up afterwards. So a highlight of my career is basically just getting beat up and kicked in the balls. Because it happens in every match. I've got like almost every single one of I've been able to get footage of like almost all my matches or every match I've been involved with, and like I get low blowed in I think every one of them but one. Like I don't know why people just like low blowing me and kicking me in the head when I go down.
Let's try to make that a habit when the shows come back. Right, so we'll do our stupid questions that we ask, and then we'll look to the future when the pandemic's over. So you listened to Don's one, so you know what one of them is at least. We've added a new one since. So first off, what's your favourite dinosaur?
Favourite dinosaur, I'm going to say Spinosaurus because of Jurassic Park 3.
Fair enough. I like it when people give me a reason. I haven't said it in a while, but my favourite one is still Turkey Dinosaur. That's Oh dear. I went to well, we've got a food warehouse, not in Iceland. It's the same thing here up in Elgin. But I saw turkey dinosaurs I was looking at, and it still makes me laugh that someone gave me that answer as favourite dinosaur. It's the best. Anyway,
I just found out they're doing quorn ones now. My friend is vegan and they messaged me the other day and they're just like, you know how you like dino nuggets or whatever, and I'm just, because I'm a child, and I'm just like, yeah, and I'm just like, they're doing quorn ones now, and I'm just like, well, I'm not going to bloody eat them. Oh, but I can have them now.
So taking the fun out of it.
Exactly.
I was speaking to Ellie Armstrong. This could be the episode before this one goes out. She's a vegan, and she was pretty much saying that corn is no to corn. So give me something that tastes, that she was giving me these tips about stuff that looks and tastes like chicken. It's got the texture of chicken. I was like, yeah, that'll be the only thing that might get me onto the vegetarian or vegan train is if it tastes like meat.
Yeah. I have a lot of vegan and vegetarian friends, and obviously, oh, you should try this. It tastes like chicken. I was like, no, what else tastes like chicken?
Chicken. another question is, which I felt really bad asking her because she's a vegan. What would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow? See, it's a thinker. Nobody thinks it's going to be like a serious question. Now, when I ask it, there's always a pause. Like,
I'm going to say sheep. Like, two sheep would take the cow.
Any particular reason? Is there a plan, logic behind it? I mean, I think sheep as well.
Okay, I'm going to be like really sad. I watch a YouTube channel called The Hoof GP. He is such a good show, but is such a good channel. Basically, he's sorry, my battery's going low for a second there. That's fine. So he goes to farms and he basically does hoof maintenance on all the cows. And he'll put like plastic blocks on because they've got infections or the blisters or that. Cows' feet are manky. Like, they get so messed up and so, like, I think how they can, some of them can barely walk properly. So I'm gonna say the sheep can take it because the cow's feet are going to get all messed up in the field, and the sheep will just be like, bang, and they'll be over.
Right, as your battery's going then, we'll get the last couple of questions in.
Is it 20%? So that's 20%.
So if it's an iPhone or that, it goes like 20, 18, dead. So I know from experience. So looking to the future then, no wrestling happening just now because, you know, pandemic. Yeah. And, of course, the company you were with, you're no longer affiliated with or wanting to be affiliated with. So what...
There is a thing about that. Like, they talk crap about me now. I offered to go back, not when I left. I didn't offer to go back. I said, when I left, if you ever want me to come back and do a spot, like just make up numbers, more than happy to, like, more than happy to come help you guys out. Cause I was quitting. I was like, I'm done with this and I don't really need to do anything else. And then they started talking crap and I was like, okay then, I know where to go now. I know what I'm doing. So like, I'm not bitter, but I offered like an olive branch to say, I'm not, because I said, I don't want to mess you guys over. I don't want to mess you up, but I can't be around wrestling. And I was thinking legitimately that I was going to quit. And then that happened. I was like, well, okay then. That was nice of them to do the things that they do the things or say the things I've said or not say the things since I've left. So I'm like, okay, I know what's going on. But I'm obviously not affiliated with them anymore. Never will again because of the stuff that's happened since.
And if anyone goes online, they'll find out. Like, so we try to keep us a happy, podcast.
Yeah,
we won't go into mudslinging, but which we probably could. We might after I hit stop recording. But
yeah, absolutely.
So, what's your aspirations?
I've got some stories.
Oh, I bet you do. What's your aspirations then? Which companies are you wanting to try and get to when shows open up again?
Everyone. I would love to go to. I'd love to go do something in W4DL. Obviously, FCW is talking of, talking about, they've already announced shows in, I think they've got one Perth already and they've announced one in Dundee. So they're moving into Dundee. I want to be involved. I'm most likely going to be training with them once they're able to get their school up and running. There was the Pride wrestling that's setting up in London to do, and they wanted to feature like LGBTQ wrestlers. I know that a few people have put in word for me. I've not had anything back. I was very early in my career. I don't have like a lot of footage where I can send people saying, hey, look at this great match, because I don't have that stuff. But I'm hoping I get to do something with them eventually. But really, I just want to, my goals kind of, I want to do a tour. Like, even if it's just like 3 days, and I know W3L do tours, so hopefully I can like put the work in and get to the point where they'll be willing to book me and do a, like, let me go on one of those.
I'll probably see you up here then, because usually do their tour up north, and that's where, yeah, I can see them.
Yeah. But like, really, just really, it's really anywhere. Like, I don't have, I feel like I'm, like I say, what we said earlier about, like, I started training when I was 28. I'm 31 now. I'm never going to get to WWE. I'm never going to get to New Japan. But that's, like, I was never going to get there anyway. But I would love to go work, like, across Europe. I'd like to do some stuff. I'd like to go to Japan and do something, even, like, the small companies there. America. I'd love to do stuff like that before that I reach the age of 40 and, like, my knees are completely shot. Because I did the best thing of, like, messing up my knees and then started wrestling training, because that is how it is meant to be done.
Of course, yeah, that's the order.
Yeah, so, like, just those two, W3L, FCW, I'd love to do something with Pride. Actually, I was actually talking with someone beforehand about an idea of doing a Pride show in Scotland before they announce anything, and I think someone in Glasgow announced they were going to be doing one at the same time I was talking to someone else about, hey, this would be really cool if we could do this, especially since there's a Pride festival thing in Dundee now. That would be really cool if we could try and, like, maybe see if we could get a ring down where they're doing it and have a couple of matches and try and feature Scottish LGBTQ wrestlers, because that's the thing about the one in London is, and I understand why they would do it. They're going to focus on the English wrestlers and the ones who are around that area, because it's going to be cheaper for them to come in and travel. Getting the guys down from Scotland, it's a bit more difficult. So something to do in Scotland, that. But I just want to wrestle someplace. And I would like to wrestle locally so I can do it for my friends and family.
And say with opponents, you've already mentioned you'd love to step in with John Kerr again. Yeah. Is there any what would be your, say you had the choice to wrestle anyone that's still active nowadays, who would it be?
Finn Balor,
Chris Jericho.
On the Scottish scene, there's some really great young guys in ICW. Like, I'm nowhere near the level that I'd need to be to sort of face these guys, but like guys like Daz Black and
Logan Smith.
I remember, possibly. I've completely blanked on the guy's name, but there's a couple of young guys there. It's like I think they're doing amazing like stuff. They're really young. I'm just like, that's like great opportunity for them guys. Never met them, but like it's good to see like young guys getting that opportunity to like appeal on like the WWE network. That's fantastic. Guys that I've worked on shows with, guys like Luke Aldridge. I think Luke is vastly underrated. I would love to work something with him. I'd love to do something with Zach Leon, because I went to school with Zach. We went to the same high school together, and he's coached me a bit when he was taking classes at the Dundee company. And it was really cool for me. I won the showcase, he won the future on the same night. And I was just like, two guys from Morgan Academy, we became wrestling champions on the same night together. That's kind of cool. And I have a picture of the two of us with the belts just after we won, which I'm sure he's like thrilled about. But for me, it was a cool moment, because we weren't friends. We knew each other, but we weren't like close friends in that. We're not close friends now, but like, It was still kind of cool, like two guys who just like knew each other as kids, but like both like end up in the same company and end up becoming champions same night. It was cool.
And then, well, that's it. That's our whole interview done. We've gone over an hour, which When I was doing my research, I was thinking, oh, I might struggle getting an hour here, but we've just ended.
Oh, no, no. Anyone who knows me would have told you, no, you're not going to have a trouble getting me to talk.
Right. So before we go then, before I hit stop recording and before I end up hitting the screen with my hands, damn you, Steve Austin, where can people find you on social media?
So Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and now TikTok, which will never actually get used. It's just so I can watch TikToks. It's at JLobinPro. That's it. Like, everything's under the same thing. And if you want to email me, it's at JLobinPro@gmail.com.
Cool. Perfect. Well, thank you very much for joining me today.
No problem.